Hello, we will start with NCERT chapter 9 for class 7. This chapter talks about making of regional cultures. Now, as we know, whenever we try to associate people, there are certain basic factors we try to include. We associate them based on language, based on religion, based on the region they live in, the food, the customs, the dance, the music in the region, and so on and so forth. So based on these parameters, you try to associate people. For example, people speaking Uriya language would be from Orissa, people speaking Tamil language would be from Tamil Nadu, so on and so forth. So these regional cultures are a kind of result of the intermingling of various traditions that exist within the society. Now we will talk about some of these examples. So we will take a case study from Kerala, another from Bengal, some from Rajasthan and so on. So our first case study is Cheras. Now Cheras was a kingdom of the southwest part of India, as we can say the present day Kerala. So it was established in 9th century and it was known as the Chera kingdom of Mahodayapuram, and the language in this region, this kingdom, was Malayalam. The script was Malayalam as well. In the first literary work of Malayalam started in 12th century, and this Malayalam language was among the earliest examples of using regional cultures or regional languages in the official records. Again, the temple theater of Karnataka got many stories from Sanskrit epics but finally translated it into Malayalam. The 14th century work known as Leela Tilakam deals with the grammar and the poetry, and it was composed by Maniparvalam, which means the diamonds and the corals. So it talks about the language, literature and the regional culture. The next is the Jagannatha Cult. Jagannatha Cult is the cult that worships the Jagannath, the statue of Jagannath in Puri, Odisha. So Jagannath means Vishnu, so they are a devotee of Vishnu. Mainly they make wooden images of the deity, and the temples are erected in the 12th century by Anant Varman. And Anant Varman was from Ganga dynasty. He built up finally the temple of Jagannath Puri. In 1230, the king Anga Bhima II dedicated his kingdom to Jagannath, and he said that we are just the deputy to the god Jagannath. Slowly and gradually, temples gained importance during this period. Now, similar to what we have seen in South India, in Kerala and Odisha, you had Rajasthan that was developing up. So, in the Rajasthan, you had the Rajput cult that was seen. During the 19th century, it was the state of Rajputana during the British time. The ideas and the aspirations were linked to the rulers of that time. Prithvi Raj was one of the major leaders. There are many poems and songs dedicated to Prithvi Raj Chauhan, for his valor and heroism. So most of the situations and emotions are being depicted under this. Women were also involved in the activities of valor, and sati was a common practice where the woman used to jump into the funeral pyre of the husband. Now the next important is the dance, and then we will talk about the paintings. So under the dance you have Kathak that emerged in northern India, and it was derived from the word Katha, which is used in Sanskrit. Now the word Katha depicts a caste of North India who were primarily storytellers, so they used to roam around and tell stories. This dance practice evolved in the 15th and the 16th century more with the spread of Bhakti movement, and finally they later on included the Radha Krishna folk plays that was part of it. Later on it was also performed in the Mughal kingdom, and you had two gharanas that were developed for Kathak. One was the Jaipur gharana and another was the Lucknow gharana. Under Wazid Ali Shah, who was the last Nawab of Awadh, this concept grew very rapidly, and by 19th century it is spread to most of the North India. So Punjab, Haryana, Jammu, Kashmir, all of these were not untouched. Later on it became one of the six major classical forms of music. Now understanding classical is very important. So classical music or classical dance, sorry, not classical music, classical dance. Classical dance is a form of dance which is based on certain set of rules, and there are other classical forms as well. So out of the six classical forms, Kathak was given as one of the forms of dance. The other forms were Bharatnatyam in Tamil Nadu, Kathakali in Kerala, Odissi in Odisha, Kuchipudi in Andhra Pradesh, and Manipuri in Manipur. Now the next important, as we said, was paintings. Now paintings has been a part of the art and culture since a long period. However, with the Mughal advent, you had miniature painting concept that came into being. Miniature, as the name suggests, is a small size. So you had paintings on smaller sets of cloth or paper or wood, and these paintings were done with watercolor. Previously they were done with the palm and the wooden leaves. It illustrated the various Jain teachings. Again, during the period of Mughal emperors like Akbar, Jahangir and Shahjahan, these miniature paintings were part of the manuscripts, which were historical accounts, and they were depicting the social life of the people. They were mainly drawn in dark and brilliant colors. Now, slowly and gradually, what happened is these painters moved from the Mughal court to the hilly areas or the Rajput areas of Rajasthan. So they had the regional centers that was shifting to Deccan, to Rajasthan and the hills. So you had in Rajasthan, Mewar, Jodhpur, Bundi, Kota and Kishangarh, which developed their own forms of painting. We'll be discussing the forms of paintings and the various forms of dance separately under the classes on Indian culture. So you can combine that lecture for this. Now coming on to the hilly areas, Himachal Pradesh was a major center during the 17th century. You had a painting form which was known as Bhasholi, which was very very common, and it was one of the popular texts painted was Banu Bhatta's Rasmanjari. And slowly and gradually, with the conquest of Delhi and Nadir Shah invasion, most of the artists moved to Himachal Pradesh in the northern hills. In the hills itself, you had Kangra school of painting that was started, and this painting school basically focused on Vaishnavite traditions. So they mainly include the cool colors like green and blue for painting, and they had a kind of rhythm that they tried to set up in the painting. Now moving on to the other corner of India was Bengal. Now Bengal was important because what we see is the present day West Bengal, but this Bengal included the West Bengal and the East Bengal during that time. The predominant language here was Bengali, and most of the Bengali literature was derived from Sanskrit text. However, some of it was not derived from Sanskrit, and that included tribal language, the other regional language. Now we'll see how the things move forward. So during the 3rd and the 4th century BC, Bengal and Magath had good ties. So Magath occupied the southern parts of Bihar, and they brought in Sanskrit into the region. Then during the 4th century, Guptas occupied the northern part of the Bengal, and their exposure grew far and wide. During the 7th century, you had Chinese traveler who was known as Zhuangyang, who tried to relate the language to Sanskrit and tried to spread it across Bengal. 8th century, you had the Pala dynasty that was established. During the 14th to 16th century, sultans came, and these were the independent rulers of Delhi. In 1586, you had Akbar, who conquered the Bengal region. And during the period of Akbar, Persian became the language of administration. However, the regional language remained Bengali. Now, during the 15th century, numerous dialects in Bengali got united under a common language, and that was the Bengali language. So the Bengali language was divided into two categories, one which owed its origin to Sanskrit and other which owed its origin to non-Sanskrit language. The one that owed its origin to Sanskrit included Sanskrit epics, Mangal Kavya, which were the auspicious poems during that time and were related to the Bhakti movement. Chaitanya Dev was one of the major leaders who propagated the Sanskrit literature of Bengali. And he was a core Vaishnav. The next was non-Sanskrit. Non-Sanskrit was practiced mainly by the Naths. The main among those were Mainamati and Gopichandra. Gopichandra was the son of Mainamati. And then you had Dharma Thakur, who is worshipped in stone and wood. So fairy tales and all the stories are sung and told about them. But all of these are only oral. There is no written presentation of these. Again, this was common mainly in the eastern part of Bengal. However, the Sanskrit section was common in the western part of the Bengal. And this eastern part of the Bengal, there was non-Sanskrit dominance because the influence of Brahmins was very less in this region. Again, the very important thing, the Brahmins of across India did not have non-vegetarian diet. However, the Brahmins in Bengal took the non-vegetarian diet as fish because they considered this to be the locally available staple food, and the Bengal Brahmins ultimately took fish as the part of their diet. Now, Pirs and Temples is again very important. During the 16th century, many people migrated from the less fertile areas to more fertile and forested areas. Slowly and gradually, they started clearing the forest for rice cultivation. Rice and fish became the staple food in the areas of Bengal. So, there were many small communities and shifting cultivators who merged into the peasant community, and they tried to establish a Mughal rule. So it coincided with the Mughal rule that came into the region, and Dhaka became the capital. Now, Pirs were worshipped because Pirs were considered to be people with supernatural powers, so they could have magical treatment for all your illnesses. Again, these people were respected, and there were community leaders who emerged from Pirs. They belong to various Hindu, they basically worship various Hindu and Buddhist deities, and also some of those did not worship in any form of gods or animism. Now, during the 15th to 16th, 19th century, many temples were built in Bengal. Most of them were terracotta temples, and the people who worked for those were Kolus and Kansaris. Kolus were the oil presses and Kansari were the bell metal workers. Now, as the European trading community invaded into the area, you had new economic activities that started to come up. However, the temples were mainly double roofed, which were known as dolcha, or four roofed, which were known as chauchala. And this chauchala or four roofed were basically, you had the four triangle roof on a square platform or a square base, and the interior was kind of plain. However, towards the outer side, they decorated it with various designs. Now, one of the excellent temple architecture comes from Vishnupur in Bankura district of West Bengal. We already talked about how fish was very important for Bengalis, and many of the temples even had the decoration of fish and people carrying fish baskets in the paintings on the outer edges. Now, as we talked about Bengal Brahmins consuming fish as a diet, this was permitted under Brihadharma Puran, which was a 13th century Sanskrit text which was from Bengal. Now, similar to the things that were happening in India, across the world you had the concept of nation state that emerged. Now, till now, there were regions which were subject to empire, for example the Austro-Hungarian Empire and so on. However, after the 18th century, people tried to identify themselves based on languages. So, you had French people from France speaking French language, German people from Germany speaking German language. Similarly, in the 19th century, Romanian schools separated from Greek because they had their own Romanian language. Then you have the Hungary people who separated from Latin because they spoke Hungarian, and so on and so forth. However, during the late 19th century, there was a process of unification that started, and you had the Italian and German unification that later on started. So this was the development. So language, religion and region had been the main source of distinguishment that was done during that time. So with this we cover the 9th chapter. We are left with just one more chapter for class 7, and we'll be finishing that in couple of days. So stay tuned. Have a good day ahead.